Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show here on Urban TV. Feel free to get in touch with us and tell us where you're watching from. But also, there's a lot happening, including the university quiz that will start on Friday. So feel free to watch and see which university has the brains. I'm not saying some don't have brains. I just say that those that will be on top of the others. So yes, there'll be the quiz happening here on Urban TV. You have every reason to watch them and see how the youngsters in these universities, just how brilliant they are, or what areas, you know, are lacking in what they are studying. That will be coming up on Friday, so make a date with us. Let's get back to The Business Show. And this week on how to make money, we're talking running a bridal transport business. Now, this young gentleman, Shadrach Mwesije, yes, he is the founder of Mesh Executive Services. After what, his university worked a bit and then later realized the money wasn't enough, which is almost similar issue for most of us. Yeah, the money can never be enough. But along the way, opted to start up this bridal transport services or business, which is now thriving 6 years later. He says he's making profits, but also he doesn't forget the fact that during COVID, it was a hell of a time for them in that space because they could only do what, one wedding or so because of the lockdown and all that. This week, we speak to him to tell us just how he has been running this business, what makes him stand up, how does he beat competition, but also a business diversification. He has gone into safaris, which he says it is simple, simply because it is still within the theme business space. This is how to make money this week.
My name is Shadrach Mwesije, and I'm the founder of Mesh Executive Services. So Mesh Executive Services, we basically do bridal car hire, we do executive corporate transport, we do boat cruise, we do motorbike escorts, and the close protection services. So basically that's what we do, Mesh Executive Services. So Mesh Executive Services started in six years ago, and it was just a little bit of some challenge we got when I was organizing one of my friend's wedding. So we looked for genuine service providers of cars. So we paid this gentleman and we were really disappointed on the deed. So from that time I decided maybe this is something that we need to change. So that idea crossed my mind of starting the executive services, bridal car hires. And so far, of course, the start wasn't good. We didn't have any car, we didn't know where to start from. But of course, as time kept on moving, then we stabilized in the business. And so far, not bad.
All right, Shadrach, thank you so much for speaking to us on The Business Show this week. I like the fact that out of a problem, you saw an opportunity. Yeah, after you failed to get, after this guy failed you guys on the D-Day, you opted to go out to this. Maybe let's start from here. How has the business then been since you started?
I would say during the first year, it wasn't easy because we didn't have any car. Actually, I didn't own any car. Actually, I was more of like a broker getting a car from this person to give to the clients. And even getting clients once wasn't easy because nobody could trust us with their events. But what has made us really stand out and what has made us pick up is just delivering as we promise. You deliver as you promise. If a client comes and I tell them, okay, I'm going to give you a Range Rover, exact, I bring that. If I tell them I'm going to bring a Mercedes Benz, I bring that. We have never disappointed any client, and we don't have any bad record about that. So that has given us an upper hand that we managed to save some money. People are referring, okay, go to Mesh Executive Services. Mm. So the referrals were really good, and we managed to make some small money. We saved, and on the second year, we bought one car. On the third year, we bought another. So that's how it has been moving. Mm. The credit goes to our delivering time and not disappointing clients. Okay. That has been our trademark.
All right. So I know you'd have opted for any other means of, you know, offering these services. Where did you opt for the executive one, or the luxurious cars, you call them?
Actually, I realized that there are Ugandans that are willing to pay an extra fee for the good services offered. Basically, when it comes to their functions, they are willing to pay an extra money. So I realized that there is that niche that we needed to tap into. And they are willing, they are there, yeah. So it might sound funny, but they are there. Mm. Yeah, so that's why I opted for the executive ones. Yeah, not the common cars, but the executive cars. Because people want this pomp and glamour, you know, airport pickups, musicians coming into the country. They want that nice car. They wouldn't opt for the low-end cars. They opt for high-end cars. So there's some bit of, there's a market for those.
Which comes with the cost? Maybe let's talk about the costing then.
The cost depends on the type of car you want. Mm-hmm. For example, if you want a Range Rover, it depends also on the route plan. Around the Kampala, the prices are different.
Yeah.
If someone for example, an event in Gulu, in the upcountry.
Yes.
So it's different, it depends on the route plan. So the more fancy the car is, the more the price. But of course, you have cars for all levels of people.
Yes.
It's nothing like, okay, this is specifically for high-end people. No. We have there's a low budget, there's middle budget, and there's high budget.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So I am sure managing these cars that are within your space is probably costly. What other costs do you incur as a business person?
Yeah, it's a bit costly somehow because there are some unexpected challenges that can occur.
Yeah.
For example, this is a high-end car. Mm. For example, you're in a G-Wagon. That's a G-Wagon, is a very expensive car. If anything happens to that car, the repairing, the spares are really very expensive. So you just have to be really very cautious with your drivers. You have to guide them. And most of these cars are insured. So try to avoid all that in the case of anything happens. But of course, they are hard to maintain. Even the services, actual maintenance is quite a little bit expensive.
Hmm.
But as in the business, you have to calculate all that and you plan for them in advance.
All right, so 6 years you've been doing this. Let's just go fast backwards. COVID. What did you do during COVID?
Actually, that was one of the worst moments we had during COVID.
Yes.
Actually, COVID business was totally down.
Yes.
People were doing weddings for 10 people, so they couldn't opt for, people weren't working. Mm. They couldn't opt for nice cars. They couldn't opt for something fancy. So they would just do a simple wedding.
Mm.
So business was really down. I have to accept that. It was really down. So actually, it was during that period of time that you had to sit and brainstorm. That's when the idea of starting Mesh Safaris came into play. Because you could think about, you know, laying off all these people. So you say, no, let's try to diversify. So we did Mesh Safaris. Yeah, that Mesh Safaris actually was born in during COVID time.
Ah.
Yeah, but so far not bad also, so far so good. So okay. We didn't want to lose all these people, just had to create something else to employ them.
The fact that you guys try and deliver on time, which is, you know, customer satisfaction is key for every business. So as a young man, what are some of the other attributes that you think you've paid keen attention to keep this business running 6 years later?
I would say being transparent, not disappointing clients. Because this is a business whereby I'm going to handle an event and you're going to recommend something like 6 people to us. Yeah. So one thing I've realized that you have to really be cautious when it comes to delivering to clients. You deliver what you've promised and not disappoint. Because this wedding is something which is very sensitive. Even if it's not a wedding, even if it's just an airport pickup or picking up corporate transport of CEOs, so you have to deliver. So the more you are legit with what you are doing, the more you deliver on time, the more you deliver as promised, people are going to recommend you. They're going to refer as many clients as possible. So one thing I've realized, just do what you've agreed with the clients to do. Don't divert. Don't say, okay, I didn't bring this. Even if there is a problem with that car, please try to explain in advance and offer a solution. That's what I do. In the case there's some glitch,
okay,
I try to explain to the client. I'm like, okay, this is a Range Rover Sport, but okay, let me give you a Range Rover Volk. So even if it means getting losses on your side as a company, I do so to make sure that I keep the reputation nice in the face of a client.
Okay.
Yes.
Are there events you handle and you feel, okay, maybe we didn't do, you know, as expected, and then does it then turn like a learning point for you to even do better?
Yeah, not.
Are there lessons you pick from event, every event, and then you build on to run your business more smooth?
Yeah, because at first, I never introduced the red carpet theme of like, okay, putting on a red carpet so that clients can walk on the red carpet.
Yes.
So it was one wedding, then a client like, oh no, I saw this wedding in Dubai, and there was a red carpet. You guys don't have a red carpet. So I'm like, oh, okay. I think I should also
typical.
Consider that.
Yes.
So it gave me a good idea, actually. Mm. It's very nice and it gave me a good idea. Mm. So, of course, every event you do, it gives you a lesson. Either you get satisfied or you think of doing the next event better.
Mm.
Yeah.
How do you beat competition? Because I know you're not the only person. I've seen several others. How do you beat competition?
Yeah, of course. Actually, beating competition is one. Deliver as promised. Deliver as promised and deliver good quality work.
Mm.
Yeah. And deliver nice cars that have AC, because you can imagine where the bride and groom sitting in the car and they doesn't have an AC. It's really a big turn off to clients.
Mm.
So just be transparent, deliver as promised. Then the rest, people will start recommending you and the business will move smoothly.
Mm.
Yeah, there are many people, of course, who do the same. But again, you find that most of other companies, we know each other.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we know each other. We help each other. In case I don't have this, I can call company B to call me to give me this.
Mm.
Yeah. So we normally work together. Competition is not bad. It's part of business.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, needless to say, if you're going to offer quality products or quality services, then you must maintain that. Clients like associating with people that mean business and people that offer what they promise. You do not want to tell the clients that you can do something if you can't, because in the long run, you could, you know, pass in, out, but you will get affected along the way. So be honest as a business person. Learn from the others and also see opportunities of how you can grow. You realize that Shadrach opted to diversify a bit, but also his decision to diversify is still in the same space of transport. So if you're choosing to diversify, choose a business that helps you stay within the same track of operations. Don't do a bridal business and then the second business is something different that, you know, will somehow drag your time off this first business. And also always ensure that you only diversify if you're sure that your first business is stable and it can stand on its own. That is how to make money. I hope you learned something from Shadrach if you're planning to start any business. Now let's talk personal finance tips for this week, and no doubt that we have just a few a month or so or two to the end of the year, and probably there are goals that you did set up that didn't work out and you're probably thinking, so what next, where do we go from here? This week on personal finance tips, we want to talk to Augustine Tamale, who is the chief finance officer of Vision Group, who talks to us about how you need to review shortfall and minimize expenses before the year ends. That could just help you recover some of the money that has been lost through the last 9 or 10 months of the year. Yes, this is personal finance tips for this week.
Greetings, I'm Augustine Tamale, and I'm the chief finance officer of Vision Group. This year is coming to a close, 2023. We just have a few months to go. And in life, you set out to achieve a number of things at particular times. So you might have set out to achieve particular developments within your life this year. Maybe you set out to buy land, probably to start a farm, or to embark on a construction, maybe just to lay the foundation for that construction or pay for its building plan, because it's also a process. And probably you were to add on another business line, whatever you had set out to do this year, probably you've not attained all that you set out, maybe a portion. It is worse if nothing at all has been achieved, but that's not the end of life. Always there is a way you can catch up with what you have missed on getting in life. So when you realize that you've not achieved what you've planned to achieve, then you sit back and review what has been the shortfall. What is the cause of that shortfall? And I think that in some instances, it has to do with the cost of living. Probably the costs of your survival have gone beyond what you expected them to be. And this year, inflation was running quite high for food and fuel. It was quite high. Yes, I know even COA and the general headline inflation were high, but not as high as fuel and food. Those ones were too high. At some point, they were still in double-digit figures. So buying fuel, buying food has been too expensive for an ordinary citizen. And such costs can eat into what you would have saved for investment, what you would have saved for development. So your plans then can get jeopardized. So look and see what has gone wrong. Was it these costs of living? Could you have supplied yourself some of these things? That's another major thing to look at. Is there a scenario where you would have done your own production such that you don't have to spend? Because that would reduce on the flow of money from your wallet, from your bank account, and it would help at least either improve on the number of bags of cement you would have bought for construction, or the amount of money that you were saving for that piece of land would have increased a bit. But probably you have been spending a lot. What could you have produced on your own to reduce this expenditure? I usually talk about the food. Even urban farming is possible. If you pay a visit to the KCCA production site in Chanja, you will realize that you can do urban farming from a small area. So are you able to plant onions as part of the flowers in your home? Are you able to plant lemongrass such that you can spice your tea without paying for the spices? What else can you plant right where you are staying? So even if you're a tenant, you're allowed to have flower pots. So what can you put in those flower pots? Not just the typical flowers for making the veranda look nice, the balcony look nice. You can have some flowers which are really plants for your nutrients, which are spices for you, and it helps on minimizing your expenses. If you are in your own home, you are in your own property, then you can take it a notch higher. Probably mushrooms, you could have planted mushrooms, produce on your expenditure. What else could you do by yourself such that you do not have to release that amount of money? Even you could do some few croilers with you and they could lay eggs. One time we had a child and we had a few croilers, about 3-4 of them, and each day they could give us 2-4 eggs, and that was sufficient for our family because ours is not so big. We are not the only ones called to fill this earth. We are just part of the entire corporate calling to fill the earth. So when we get 2-4 eggs, they're enough for my family, my wife and our three boys. We can feed on those 2-4 eggs per day. So that was enough for us, and that could cut off the expenditure of eggs. But how are you doing it yourself? Can't you produce the eggs for your family consumption? Yes, your home is small, so you can't do a big poultry house to do commercial poultry. But you can have little poultry that is sufficient for your own nourishment as a family. And after 2 years, these broilers are grown up, so you eat them. And then you get another stock of broilers. That reduces on your expenses. So what can you do for own production and you reduce on your expenditure? The other bit is optimal consumption. There could be excessive consumption of things in your home, and that is taking a tall order on your expenses. So look through, how is the ironing done at your home? Some of you don't even look at your yaka meters on a daily. You just look when it warns. Do you know how many units you use per day? Because personally, I check every morning, maybe probably because I'm an accountant, but every morning I look to see the past 24 hours, what did we use, such that I can see the variance. If our usual consumption is 12 units and it goes to 20, then I need to know what happened. Why is it almost double? What happened? Were there so many people ironing? What was the problem? I need to get to know what went wrong.
Well, so there you have it from Augustine. We have fourth part series that will be coming up through to the end of the year. I just want to see how we can inspire you and your businesses. Also, how you can grow your finances, the opportunities that you can invest in, and how you can turn around what hasn't been working for you. Okay, let's then run you through the Forex and the money market report for this week. Well, I guess I have to go now, but feel free to get in touch with us all the time. That's all we had time for on the program this week. Thank you so much for making time. Now, a shout out to my friend Vincent. He was telling me about some good idea that needs to be looked into. I'm talking about Vincent Kagame. He's a business rescue doctor. And he was just saying, maybe sometimes these businesses need to first think. I mean, the owners of the businesses have to think before they shoot or make that decision, which is something that is too general, really. For you as a business person, before you make a decision, what are some of the things you pay attention to? Do you just wake up and move because you have money, or there are key things that you need to do to study how to manage that business that you want to handle? From myself and the team, it's good night, and thanks for watching.